Welcome to Talk Emergency Medicine. My name is John Belinsky from the Emergency Medicine Institute, and today we're talking about a five-part chapter on shortness of breath. Anytime you have a patient with any kind of pulmonary symptoms, you do not want to make a horrid mistake. Now, this is super, super, super important. Why? Because here's where you get burned. Because someone can come with a cough and easily be triaged to a fast track. I've seen it happen. I've been on medical malpractice defense cases trying to defend people who presented with the same kind of scenario. Someone comes with a cough and it's something life-threatening and sinister, but it was looked at as something benign. Today we're going to talk about that. Now, horrid is a mnemonic that is flawless, and it saved my butt many, many, many times. So anybody with pulmonary symptoms, you do not want to make a horrid mistake. Anybody with pulmonary symptoms, you don't want to make a horrid mistake. H-O-R-I-D, horrid. H is heart. Could it be their heart? Could it be CHF? O is obstruction. Could it be obstructive pathology? R is reactive, like asthma COPD. Could it be infectious? I, like pneumonia. D is death from a PE or pneumothorax you didn't think about. Guys, there is no exception to this. Do not be fooled by what's called an anchoring bias, where a nurse will come in and say, hey, John, go see this asthmatic in bed two. Wait, it's not an asthmatic until I diagnose it as an asthmatic. If you latch on to that, you will miss CHF. You'll miss subtle things like a sneaky PE. So there's no such thing as asthma. There's no such thing as bronchitis until you make that diagnosis, until you've excluded the sinister components of shortness of breath. So today, I don't want to go into the five different causes because we'll use podcasts following up to talk about heart, CHF. We'll talk about obstructions and airway foreign bodies and how to make sure we can manage someone's airway. So we'll talk about that. But right now, I just want to talk about the approach to a pulmonary patient. Now, let me explain something. Where am I coming from here? Now, for first year and a half I got out of PA school back in 1997, I was a fast-track PA in Buffalo. Nothing that really gives me any kind of real credibility to be one of the speakers for the Emergency Medicine Institute, because this is really high-end emergency medicine. Well, for 4 years after that, I was a nighttime hospitalist at a hospital in Rochester, New York, which means I had to take care of the people who were sick enough to be admitted but weren't in the hospital yet. I'm sorry, they weren't in the ICU. They were admitted, and my job was to admit them, but they weren't in the ICU. So I managed those patients that were capable to be on the floor, to be on a pulmonary unit, med-surg, hem-onc, nephrology. I covered all those patients. If they crashed, I was the first one that got that phone call. And we had a floor, 3300, which was our pulmonary wing. We had some vented patients, a lot of BiPAPs. If you're a tube, you went to the unit. But the bottom line is I had to take care of a lot of pulmonary disease. And to be real clear about this, guys, I kept screwing them up. Like, I got really comfortable on telemetry. I became an ACLS instructor and, you know, arrhythmias. I got really pretty comfortable with that. The cardiologists, I gained their respect, but I kept screwing up the pulmonary stuff. I think something was reactive airway disease and it was infectious. I thought it was infectious and it was CHF. So I hit a threshold one time where I made a mistake. I misread something or misread a chest x-ray, gave someone a medication that wasn't quite what they needed, and I just got pissed. Same thing happened to me when I was a kickboxer. You know, I was a traditional taekwondoist growing up, and a taekwondoist, if you fight full contact taekwondo, you can't punch to the face. You can kick to the face, but typically you hold a lower guard. When I started kickboxing and full contact fighting in the ring, clearly you can punch to the face. Well, I was so used to holding a low guard, I'd get my ass kicked. Like, I'd get pummeled, and I'll never forget this little 16-year-old Russian kid. He whacked me right in the nose so hard my eyes teared up, and I said, I am never getting punched in the nose again. So I kept my hands a whole lot higher after that. It was a real pivotal turning point. And I felt the same way with pulmonary patients. I hit a point where I said, listen, I am sick of getting burned here. So what I did was for about a year, every time they called me with someone with a pulmonary problem, I did a chest x-ray and a blood gas. And then I went and examined them. And I got really good at assessing a patient using a blood gas and a chest x-ray to help me make this assessment. And I became pretty comfortable with taking care of people who are short of breath over that period of time. And now I don't need blood gases all the time or chest x-rays all the time, but I had to go through that learning process. Horrid is a flawless mnemonic that will save your butt. Anytime someone's got any kind of pulmonary symptoms, heart, obstruction, reaction, infection, death. Now, a couple things I want to say to you. When it comes to chest pain, the American Heart Association teaches us that Mona greets all patients at the door. You can give them morphine, oxygen, nitrates, and aspirin, even before you know what it is. It's a way to have a therapeutic intervention while you're figuring things out. And quite frankly, it buys you a little time to read that EKG. Now, there's really nothing like that when someone comes in with pulmonary symptoms, especially if they're really sick. And I'd like to offer an approach. One of the things I always did was four things. If somebody comes with pulmonary symptoms, especially if they're moderately or to severely sick, one, two, three, four. Number one is they get oxygen 100% of the time. Don't pass go. Don't collect $200. And do not worry about someone retaining carbon dioxide in their breathing shutting down. Now, that's a big, it's something that I think's hurt us more than helped us. If you have someone that's got that reverse hypoxic drive because they're a CO2 retainer, if you give them oxygen, will they stop breathing? And the answer is they'll dwindle. It's not like, oh, they're out. They dwindle. And the thing is, ladies and gentlemen, we'll talk about blood gases when we talk about reactive airway disease. When someone starts retaining carbon dioxide, quite frankly, they look like one of the seven dwarfs. Do they look like happy? Do they look like grumpy? No, they look sleepy. So when I have a patient who's retaining carbon dioxide, they will be somnolent. And that's a clinical diagnosis. I can tell if they're retaining carbon dioxide. So number one is, if someone comes in and they're hypoxic, they're squirrely. If they're hypercarbic or retaining carbon dioxide, they become sleepy. So give them oxygen, always. Don't pass go. Don't ever tell me someone's got an O2 sat of 88% and you don't have oxygen on them. It's a gross mistake. It's gross negligence. Number two is, give them a DuoNeb, okay? Give them preventil Atrovent. You may have other people give you different feedback here. I do not feel it will harm anyone. Yes, you become mildly tachycardic with the preventil. I've never seen but one time it caused any kind of problems at all. And that one time was someone who came in with an asthma exacerbation because he's a hot, heavy smoker and a heavy drinker. And he was starting to go through alcohol withdrawal. So when we gave him a preventil neb, it actually put him into like an SVT. And then we had to break that. It was just a little bit of a fiasco, but overall, it's very well tolerated. Remember, ipratropium, the Atrovent, is an anticholinergic. Okay, mild inconvenience because it drives people out to give you anticholinergic side effects, but I'm telling you my experiences. If I have someone who I'm not quite sure what's going on, they'll get oxygen and a DuoNeb. Then I'll order a chest x-ray and a blood gas. I'll use this to start getting data to think about what's the best way to approach this patient. Do I need to intubate them? Do I need to BiPAP them? Do I need Lasix? Do I need nitro? Do I need preventil nebs? The big way to assess the severity of a pulmonary patient is what I call the pirate owl. The pirate owl. So just think about an owl with a pirate patch on. And the owl really wanted to be a parrot. So he's got an identity thing, right? So the owl basically goes, arr, I'm an owl. Arr, I'm an owl. Okay, I know it's a stupid mnemonic, but quite frankly, I don't care about that. I don't care if it's stupid or not. Does it work? It works for me. Does it work for you? I don't know, but let me explain. When someone comes in and they're really sick, I need to know four things. I need to communicate it to docs. I need to communicate it on my paperwork. Arr, I'm an owl. R is respiratory rate. Respiratory, what's the respiratory rate? And here's the golden rule of respiratory rates, ladies and gentlemen. No respiratory rate is valid unless you took it yourself. If you didn't take it yourself, it is not valid. It is very easy for nursing staff to write down 16 for respiratory rate, but they're really breathing at 32 and they're Kussmaul breathing because they're in a metabolic acidosis. So no respiratory rate is valid unless you took it yourself. Do not believe the vital signs, at least the respiratory rate. O is O2 saturation. I need another O2 sat, and a good clinician won't give one O2 sat. I want three. What does that mean, John? Well, and I make sure paramedics know this as well. As soon as they get on scene of someone who's short of breath, I want to know what their O2 sat is as soon as they walked in on room air. Then I want to know their O2 sat after some intervention. It could be as simple as oxygen. And I also want to know their baseline. So a good clinician will give three O2 sats. Their baseline O2 sat is 95-96% from old records. When they came into the ER, they were 89% on room air after a DuoNeb and some steroids, their O2 sat is staying stable at 94% on 2 liters. That's the kind of information that you should document and communicate to a hospitalist if you want to admit them. R, I'm an owl. R is respiratory rate. O is O2 saturation. W is words per sentence. Document how they're speaking to you. If they're speaking to you like I'm speaking to you now, you can document full unpressured speech. But if they're speaking to you like this, document 5 to 7 word broken sentences. Okay, that tells me a lot. R, I'm an owl. Respiratory rate, O2 saturation, words per sentence, nail is labor. I need to see their chest, especially in kids. I need to see, do I see retractions? Do I see abnormal breathing going on? That's a big problem, okay? So especially when you're managing a pulmonary patient that's moderate to severely sick, you got to look at their thorax. You got to take that shirt off. You got to look at their breathing, especially in kids. If not, you're asking for a catastrophe. You're asking to get burned. So we're not here today to talk about indications for BiPAP. We'll talk about the, indications for intubation. We'll talk about that later. Just know that there are three major indications for intubation. Number one is the ventilation perfusion problem. Number two is to protect the airway. Number three is when you anticipate future events, what's going to happen. And that's taught by Ron Wall in the airway course. If you do intubations, or if you're an advanced practitioner and having to do intubations, or you're falling into that capacity, Ron Wall's course, it's theairwaycourse.com, is fantastic. It was one of the best courses I ever took. In review, HORID is a mnemonic for a generalized approach to people with pulmonary symptoms. Is it their heart, obstruction, reactive infection, or death? Remember that you need to bide a little time. You got to get a little time to figure out what it is, and that's when you want the two therapeutic interventions and two diagnostics. Number one is oxygen. Number two is a duodenum. Number three is do a chest x-ray. Number four is a blood gas. And then you want to assess really how sick they are and make sure you document it and communicate it. It's a pyridol, respiratory rate, O2 saturations, words per sentence, and labor. Folks, John Bolsky here from the Emergency Medicine Institute. You're listening to Talk EM. Subscribe. Subscribe so we can keep this dialogue going. And if this is helping you, share it with others. Get your colleagues involved in it. Teach this information to some of the people at work. I'll see you in the next episode.